I'm Valentin, I make stop-motion armatures for many years now, and today I want to share some tricks for soldering these ball and socket joints for your stop-motion armatures. First, let's talk about the balls of steel. Depending on where you buy your joints, the balls will either come with a threaded hole, a blind hole, or a through hole. Through holes actually behave best for soldering, but it can be very tricky to position them precisely on the rod to achieve a specific distance between two balls, so I usually prefer blind holes, and that's what I'm going to use for the main part of this video. When planning a new armature build, make sure to have a few spare balls for practice and also to compensate for any possible failures. For that reason, I usually make my own ones from bearing balls. These are usually hardened, so the first step always is to make them soft by heating until they glow red and then letting them cool down very slowly. I have used some 5C emergency collets for my lathe to create these dedicated holders, which hold the balls on center and at a specific depth, so I can repeat the following steps multiple times with ease. Then I start by milling a flat surface on the ball, which is slightly bigger than the hole I want to drill. After that, I usually use a carbide drill to form the holes. And these have the advantage that they don't require spot drilling, so no unnecessary tool changes, and also they can work without lubrication, so no cleanup needed on the parts. So this was a 6mm ball with a 2.5mm hole, and now for comparison I'm also making a 3mm ball with a 1.5mm hole, so much smaller. And on this occasion I do actually use a spot drill, because that tiny 1.5mm carbide drill is still too flimsy and tends to wander off. As a rule of thumb for the best hole diameters, just use half the ball size on small balls and slightly less on bigger balls, and always drill deeper than the center of the balls. Of course, I have a bit of a luxurious setup here with my lathe and everything, so I'm also going to show how you can achieve the same results on a regular drill press. Just create a little fixture to hold the ball in place and use some soft shims to protect the ball and the vise from any deformation when you clamp down on it. The initial flat surface can just be formed with a file, and afterwards you proceed like drilling a regular piece of steel. Of course, I also understand if you don't want to get into all this intricate metalwork, so let me just say you can also get pre-drilled balls from my colleagues at Kinetic Armatures, and on smaller ball diameters like 3 and 4 millimeters, you can also use threaded piercing balls. With that preparation done, let's talk about the actual soldering next, but first a quick word from the sponsor of this video. PCBWay offers custom-made circuit boards, 3D printing and CNC manufacturing on demand through their easy-to-use website. Just upload your files, select the material and manufacturing technique, and get an affordable instant quote, even for low quantities, which makes them super helpful for small projects and makers like us. They have helped me in the past with manufacturing this custom light board prototype for miniature lighting, and I'm really looking forward to collaborate on the next version as well. Go check out PCBWay at pcbway.com or use the special link in the video description down below. Thanks to them for sponsoring this video, and now back to soldering. For best durability, these stop-motion joints are always hard soldered with silver solder, and that's the process I'm going to show here. But I don't want to get into all the basics and safety stuff about silver soldering. There are better videos for that and you should definitely check them out first. But rather I want to focus on my experience and some key insights for soldering these stop-motion joints in particular. First, a quick word about the soldering torch, because in professional making-of videos you always see this kind of torches with separate fuel and oxygen tanks, and though it can be super helpful to have that extra performance and precision they provide, I can assure you a 15 buck butane torch from the hardware store works well enough for what we're doing here and is much safer to use for a start. I've actually used this one I got off eBay really cheap for many years, And to prove that you don't need any fancy equipment, I will also use it exclusively for all the soldering I do in this video. Now for the silver we're going to use, on larger joints I use this classic 1mm silver solder rods from the hardware store, and on more intricate occasions I resort to this 0.5mm wire or thin silver solder sheets you can buy at a jewelry maker supply. As flux I usually use this phosphorus based one, which works really well, but you might just have to try out different brands and see what works for you. All I can say is that there are some varieties like this potassium based one, which are just too coarse for the fine stuff we're doing here, and it can prevent the parts from sliding into each other well. So if you have bad luck with your joints, maybe just try out a different flux, maybe from the jewelry maker supply or something. All I can say for sure is that this particular one works well. And now finally, let's talk about the actual soldering process. Well, in all honesty, I must say, even after years of practice, I still think silver soldering is a somewhat unreliable process.
Come on!
Sometimes you just ruin a part or it looks really ugly afterwards, and that just happens. But there are indeed a few approaches you can take to improve your chances at success. First, always make sure both your parts are thoroughly clean and without oxidation, so best is just to wipe them off with a soft abrasive just before soldering, and then test fit them and make sure they fit together as intended with a tiny bit of wiggle room ideally. Generously cover the joint areas with flux on both parts before putting them together. Then put some small bits of silver near the edges, usually you'll need less than you would think, and then start by heating everything very evenly. First drying off the flux everywhere until it starts to melt. Move the torch around constantly to distribute the heat evenly, also heat it from the opposite side. And only when the silver is about to melt, it makes sense to focus on that spot where it actually is. I always see people feeding that silver rod manually while everything is hot, and though this works well on bigger parts, I would not recommend it for these small-scale assemblies, because it's super imprecise, hard to control the amount of silver you're using, and it's super easy to get silver onto all the wrong places that way. So what I recommend instead is doing it like jewelry makers, preparing some bits of silver and sticking them into the cold, wet flux, and then afterwards only focus on heating everything up evenly. It's much less risky and easier to do it that way, because you can really see what's going on, make tiny corrections if necessary, and afterwards you usually end up with a much cleaner result. Now about soldering these three types of armature balls. On through-hole balls, it's easiest to put the silver into the hole at the end of the rod, like this, and then heat everything up evenly from the opposite side until the silver starts flowing through that tiny gap. On threaded balls with threaded rods, all you can do is to put a small piece of silver on the edge and just hope it goes into the slit rather than onto the outside of the ball. Heating it from the opposite side from where the silver is can help with that. But if you end up with liquid solder onto the outside of the ball, you basically lost, because there's no way it will ever be a round ball again and you have to start all over again. Finally, when using the balls with blind holes, we can be a bit more clever. To reliably get a clean result, we can put the silver bits into the hole before sticking in the rod. Here it's super important to dry the flux before putting the pieces together, because otherwise the steam pressure can make the thing burst apart as soon as you heat it, and the last thing you want is a glowing hot bearing ball embedded into your eyeball. Safety glasses recommended, nevertheless. So with that precaution, we can start heating up the assembly evenly. Keep the flame moving until the flux is fully liquid, and then carefully press it onto the firestone until the solder starts to flow up. Give it one or two more seconds so it can flow everywhere, and then move away the torch and let it cool down. It takes a bit of practice to judge the perfect amount of silver for each size of balls and holes, but after a while you'll get pretty reliable results without the risk of silver flowing over the outside of your balls with this. With this kind of low-tech torch we're using here, you have good chances that even the best joints look rather nasty afterwards, with heavy oxidation and flux residue everywhere, so nearly as important as the actual soldering is the cleanup afterwards. Firstly, removing that flux residue works best in a heated ultrasonic cleaner, but a quick bath in hot water or vinegar also does the trick if you don't have one. Getting rid of these black oxides is a bit more difficult, and using heavy abrasive tools is not recommended because they might deform the ball, which needs to remain as round as possible. To make it easier, we can dissolve most of the oxides in a 10% hydrochloric acid solution. A minute should be enough. If you prefer working with less dangerous chemicals, you can also use half an hour in a strong citric acid solution. Afterwards, always dip the parts in a basic solution to stop the process and prevent them from rusting immediately. Now the part might not look all that different actually, but the black oxide layer should come off rather easily by just wiping it with a bit of Scotch-Brite, or the rough side of a kitchen sponge in that case. Like that, it's probably already fine for any practical purposes, but especially for commissioned pieces I usually give the balls a proper polish. This works best if you spin it with a cordless drill or a lathe. Then I use very soft sandpaper, 1000 to 3000 grit, until I achieve a mirror finish. This shouldn't distort the ball by any measurable amount, and the results just look awesome. For any non-round assemblies, like the joint blocks of single ball and socket joints, or hip and shoulder pieces, I recommend these Scotch-Brite wheels for a Dremel tool to clean it up. Okay, I hope you found this helpful. Please feel free to share your own best tricks for reliable silver soldering in the comment section down below, and like and subscribe if you would like to see more follow-ups about the topic of armature making. As always, maybe consider supporting my work on Patreon, and if you need help with a specific project, I'm available for commissions as well. Links to everything are in the description down below, and thank you so much for watching, and see you next time again. Bye bye.